Okay, so now I see Daniel Sutif returning. Daniel Sutif is a philosopher, art critic, and exhibition curator. He has addressed a wide range of themes in his various occupations, particularly as editor of Cahiers du Musée National d'Art Moderne from 1990 to 1994. He was director of cultural development at the Centre Pompidou in Paris from 1993 to 2001, and head of the Central per l'Arte Contemporanea Luigi Pici in Prato, Italy. In 2002, he edited the reference work L'Art du XXe siècle, 1939-2002, De l'Art moderne à l'Art contemporain, From Modern Art to Contemporary Art. In 2016, Daniel Sutif was the curator of a major exhibition at the Musée du Quai Branly, The Color Line, African American Artists and Segregation.
I would like to thank Arnaud Colombel for this invitation because I'm neither an academic nor a Du Bois specialist, and so I'm not sure I'm really the right person to talk about Du Bois in a so prestigious assembly. After a fantastic group like the one by Elvan. Arnaud invited me because a few years ago I created a show at the Quai Branly, which was dedicated to the African American artist. The scope of the show was to make. Ça marche plus comme ça? It's okay. It's okay now?
Yes.
Yeah. The scope of the show was mainly to present to French and European audience a lot of Black American artists, mostly unknown on this side of the Atlantic. I don't know if the level of ignorance has changed a lot since 2016 when the show opened in October. But anyway, at the time it was really a necessity. And so we worked a few years to make an important choice of artworks. But I also understood, working on the show, that it would not be possible to present the artworks without any kind of information about the story. And so you could see in the show a lot of documents, I mean books, posters, a lot of different kind of objects that were supposed to give to the audience in Paris the context in which the artworks were produced. The show was mainly historical. It was starting more or less from the end of the Civil War, and it was going to the contemporary period. And it was divided not only in historical section. Sometimes you had a thematic section which was interrupting the course of the show, of the exhibition. But you were starting with a kind of prologue. That was the entrance of the show. And we had a prologue which was there just to remember the period before the war, the slavery period, and you had a Duncanson painting, which is famous in the state, Eva and Uncle Tom, but Duncanson is completely unknown here. And we had this image, this important painting, and two pots by Dave the Potter, which were presented, they were remembering the period of the slavery. And Dave the Potter today is considered like one of the first Black American artists because he was a potter, but he used to write sentences, strange sentences. It was a kind of freedom taken against his normal job. And the third object in the prologue was the African American flag by David Amos. After that, I present just the entrance and the beginning of the show because will arrive to Du Bois, who was present in a way in the show, and I guess it's better if you see the context. So after this short prologue, there was a section dedicated to the period of the Reconstruction, and there the main artwork was not present. It was the Edmonia Lewis sculpture, Forever Free. I say that because when you make a show, you have intellectual duties, but you have also physical problems. And I've been twice in Howard University, where the work is concerned. I discussed a lot with the person in charge, and even with the help of David Driscoll, we couldn't get sculpture for the show in Paris, which was too bad. But I wanted this sculpture to be present because it's so important, the sculpture. So we decided to go there and to film it and to present it like a movie or a visual documentary about it. It was confronted with a portrait of Frederick Douglass by Charles White. And this is, I will not enter into the details, but this is an example of the kind of documentation we had confronted with the artworks. After that, we had a show which was a part of the show which was a very problematic one, because it was dedicated to the stereotypes image produced of the black people in the 19th century. You know, blackface minstrels, coon song, and so on. I guess that it was absolutely necessary to have this representation of black people, to confront those representations with the representation that will come after, produced by the by black people themselves. And that was not exactly historical, it was a thematic section, but it was referring to a precise period, the second half of the 19th century, in which those images were produced. But we were confronting those images with images produced by black artists, like the Archibald Motley, which you may see now, or an image produced by a contemporary painter named Michael Ray Charles. And we were also confronting those images with the way very important black American artists like Bert Williams were using those stereotypes to transform them in incredible artworks, creating kind of tragedy with just ridiculous production. And the main part of that section was the famous movie by Bert Williams, A Natural Born Gambler. And you had also scores showing Bert Williams, and we confronted images, contradictory images like those two. After that, we entered again in a most historical development, and we gave to that first section title that you may see, First Battle Against Segregation. And you know, when you make a show, you need to have important visual objects. And the important visual object in the show was this painting by Henry Osawa Tanner. And this painting, I will explain all this, because this is a real important aspect. This painting is showing a young boy learning to work with his hands. It's a painting that Tanner probably painted in Brittany, and the young boy is a French Briton. He's not a black boy, and but he's working with his hand, and he's constructing his future life with that kind of work. And so, painted by a man like Henry Osawa Tanner, it was a painting that was entering directly in the Booker T. Washington conception of the liberation of black people. And so we got that artwork. So it it has the effect that we dedicated an important part of the documentation to Booker T. Washington. You may see the wall that is here, and there are other books also there, but you may see, for instance, A New Era for a New Century by Booker T. Washington, and there were other books, and a part of the documentation was also dedicated to Tuskegee, and also a kind of illustrated representation of Booker T. Washington's life. After that, when you you had left this part, you could see a portrait of Booker T. Washington, again by Emilio Sawatanera, and the photographic portrait of Du Bois that you've seen already shown by Elvan. We try to express visually the confrontation between those two men. It was a kind, not exactly face to face, but the idea was to have the people understanding that there were two conceptions of the black people life and the black people future, which were confronted between those two images. But this is again Du Bois, and we had books, the famous Philadelphia Negro book, Swallows of Black Folk, and Dark Water. But there were missing images, very important missing images. The show would have been different if we could have get the banjo lesson by Emilio Sawatanera, or The Thankful Poor, always by Emilio Sawatanera. Our presentation of the dialectics between Booker T. Washington and Du Bois would have been completely different, because the Sabbath Maker is, in a way, Washingtonian visual image, but the Thankful Poor, and especially the banjo lesson, are really a Du Bois, a kind of Du Bois vision, because it's artistic education, and it has a kind of nobility which has not a lot to see with handworks, even if when you play banjo, you're using your hand. And unfortunately, banjo lesson, I went two times to Hampton University. I met Professor Harvey. I asked the help of the Terra Foundation, but it was impossible to get the banjo lesson. And we couldn't replay again the video version of, we have already Forever Free. You cannot make a show with video when you have a problem with the laws. And so we abandoned the banjo lesson and the Thankful Poor. The Thankful Poor is different because it's not owned by a university, it's owned by William Crosby, and he is not according laws. So the vision of that part of the show, and I'm not saying that it was a bad part of the show, but it was in a way disequilibrium. It had not the right equilibrium, but it's what happened when you were making show. It's not like to make a slideshow. Slideshow is easy because you have the image that you want. So said that. I show you some images which were not in the show, but that demonstrates that Du Bois was perfectly conscient of the importance of Emilio Sawatanera, and I'm sure he would have curated the show, he would have put the banjo lesson and the Thankful Poor. You know probably that in 1903 he had written a piece for the Book Lovers magazine in which three heroes were Booker T. Washington, Emilio Sawatanera, and himself. And later, he was in, not frequent, but he was often in relationship with Tanner. You asked him to participate to the Pan-African meeting in 1919, if I'm not mistaken. And he asked him to realize this illustration for a crisis cover later in 1925, I guess. And there is also this image, which is a work by Albert Alexander Smith, in which he appears. You may, I don't know if you see it, easy to see. You have Tanner and Du Bois together, really presented like close friends. And Washington is missing. you may see that also. That cover, that is the original drawing by Alexander Smith, but the cover was realized in 1925. And so, as we didn't add a painting representing Du Bois, and we needed images to give an idea of his work. And so, a very important part of his work was the crisis. Du Bois had been the chief editor of the Crisis from 1910 till 1934, if I'm not mistaken. And so that means a lot of images controlled by Du Bois, because if you look at the correspondence, you see that he was really looking for those covers. He was writing to the artist. Yeah, there is a part of the correspondence between him and Albert Alexander Smith, for instance, which was a black American artist living in Paris. So the covers are something, naturally, you should also read the content of the magazine, but we got the idea to have those images put together. And those are the 61st issue of the Crisis. And we have also another idea, which is I didn't understand clearly at the time, but now, after listening also Elvan and after seeing what Theaster Gates has done with the graphic of the 19 exhibition, 19 that we saw before, the theoretical position of Du Bois about art are known. His famous piece, Criteria of Negro Art, and his conception of art like propaganda is very well known. But maybe you may understand more of his conception about art looking at his choice, artistic choices. And those artistic choices are really well visible on the cover of the Crisis. I show you very quickly all those images. It's chronological. It's interesting to see that after the images that Elvan showed you and that you will see again, the images, I present you the Crisis before the image which came after, before the image which came before, I mean the image of the 1900 show in Paris. And because evidently it's not the same aesthetic, it's not the same idea of what an image should be, and what the same idea about graphic layout. More or less it's always the same visual sensation. Sometimes it changes a little bit, but there is really a unity. And that is the Masses, a magazine which has, which was contemporary, and Du Bois probably knew it. It was also a left magazine, and but the visual idea of the cover, and that is 1916, excuse me, and exactly contemporary of the Crisis. And it's evidently a modernist image. The artist is not very well known. He was an illustrator that worked a lot for those kind of magazines, named Frank Waltz. A few images. the same magazine. And that is even more spectacular, an avant-garde magazine in London, the magazine of the Vorticist movement. And this is the De Stijl, famous magazine that was published from 1917 in Dutchland by Van Doesburg. Clearly, those images, those last two images, are pretty modernist. Du Bois probably saw something of this, probably not De Stijl or Blast, but the masses for sure. And at a certain point, he asked Frank Valls, the same illustrator, to make some covers for the prizes. And this is, I don't know if this image is well known, but it's a portrait of Du Bois by Frans Valls.
Do you want me to turn down the light? So, ça va?
It's okay? A few images. From time to time, he had some of kind of modernist impulse, asking Frans Valls to make a cover for prizes. But if you look at the continuity of the cover, those are really examples which are interrupting a continuity of images. This one probably is the most impressive, or this one which has something like a kind of Matisse quality, always found. Okay, so after saying that, we may go back to what Elvin presented so brilliantly. We decided to present an evocation of the 1900 show in Paris. And it's interesting to note that the pavilion that Elvin showed is just on the right side, almost in front of the Cabrerie. So when we presented those images, it was a precise remembrance of some things that had happened 200 meters far. And we had this new chapter, and we tried to have the entrance of the show reproducing the vision that was on the picture that was shown already by Elvin. It didn't work perfectly because the stripes were not working exactly. And they, when I took the picture, they were already very old. And as like 200,000 people came to see the show, they were not in good condition. I underlined the presence of the images that Elvin has already shown on the picture representing the show. And I don't comment anymore this image because it has been commented by Elvin. Exposition des Nègres d'Amérique, that was the title, which was on the front of the entrance. And inside, we tried to give an idea of what was presented in 1900. A few parts of the images, of the photographic images, which were more than 500. And we made a choice. I should precise that a very valiant collaborator of the Quai-Branly, Sarah Friou-Salgas, worked on that part of the show. She wrote an excellent piece in the catalogue, and she showed the images that you are looking now. That is the way we had prepared that presentation, the graphic layout of the wall, some of the images. And this is the images that we had chosen to reproduce on the wall. Evidently, there is a strong contrast between those images and the covers of the prizes. And since I know those images since a long time, and I've always been impressed by the graphic quality of those images, but I have been always very hesitating about my sensation of those images and their reality when they were produced. Because when we look at those images with our mind of today, evidently we have strong remembrance of all the abstraction that came after. And it's also difficult to know what was exactly the part of Du Bois in the production of those images. Anyway, they are really fantastic images, and I wanted them to be seen in Paris again, and probably easier than they were when they were presented for the first time, because the presentation was a little bit problematic, probably. At the time, I didn't know, on the other side, excuse me, I didn't put the name of the writers that were in the Murray catalogue. You have seen the Murray catalogue in the presentation by Elvan. And at the time, I was not conscious of what we see now. We see now a show presented in Hollywood by Theaster Gates. Exactly at the same moment, that is January 2017. And I knew well, I had even met Theaster Gates before the Color Line show. And I had wanted to have a work by Theaster Gates in the show, in the contemporary part of the show. But at the end, it had not been possible. At the last moment, the work that we had chosen was not in New York, and so it was difficult. The costs were too big, and the Brownie didn't want to pay that money. So there were no Theaster Gates in the show, and that was I was really preoccupied by that. But I should confess that now that I know that exactly at the same time he had produced those paintings that you see behind, starting from the Du Bois graphics of 1900, really, I'm a little bit preoccupied. But anyway, it is like this, it's the truth. And so, this is a show in the Reagan Project Gallery, and you see it transformed the graphics in abstract painting. It took up all the information, statistical information, and he gave a kind of dimension, which is the dimension of a painting, and he put that in a white-black cube, which is a modernist or contemporary context, absolutely normal for artworks. And he made a lot, because you see a first room with those three, and after that there is another room with other of those paintings. More or less there are like 100 1 meter and 50 centimeter eyes, for instance. You have an idea of the size. And this is him. And what he says, I read, I realized that E. Du Bois was teaching his students art as he was teaching them statistical mapping. He was talking about how people were moving to cities and owning land and implements, mapping black asset ownerships, and he could do this empirical work with such flair. Du Bois was maybe one of the earliest black contemporary artists, which is really a funny declaration. And like very often, a contemporary is not used or completely used in the Theaster Gates statement, like a chronological concept, but much more like an aesthetical concept. Contemporary is a style, in fact, when he says that. But contemporary is the kind of presentation he gave to those images, and maybe it was not really in the actual images that you may see on the Library of Congress site, for instance. Those are the images compared to their model. And with the title, he played with the title also. And sometimes he gave the title over meaning. I'm not sure I understand everything in those titles. But it's a part of the work, I guess, the title. This is Mountain Aura, I guess he's a Benjaminian artist, and I guess he used aura in a Benjaminian sense. But if you look at the title of the original drawing by this Du Bois student, the amalgamation of the white and black elements of the population in the United States, and it becomes Mountain Aura. I don't know exactly what his intention, but I'm not sure it fits perfectly with the definition of the aura by Walter Benjamin, but maybe something has to do, because I'm not about to quote in English Benjamin, but he says something like l'unique apparition d'un lointain si proche soit-il, which means the unique apparition of something very far, as near it can be, something like this. The definition of the aura by Walter Benjamin, and the mountain aura maybe has this kind of signification. Barfri Quivilofi, this one I don't really understand well. I see the painting, and I guess it's a very good painting, but I'm not sure I understand exactly the meaning of the title. Crime Among American Negroes, Bar of the Landed. Valuation of town and city property owned by Georgia Negroes, line drawing for black people. Slaves and Free Negroes, Frenzied Negroes Adventure with Red. He's very bright because he can give his title something typically modernist, even if you don't understand exactly what he is meaning and what are his intentions. It sounds like a title of a modernist artist. American Negro Newspaper and Periodicals, Land Ownership on Conspiracy Blue. Slave, ex-slave. In that case, he had not to change a lot. Ex-slave, slaves. It's almost the same title. A Tussle in the House of Love. And it was City and Rural Population. Conjugal Condition of American Negroes According to Age Periods. Empire Frontal Section with Color. No idea of what he meant. Patterns of Life Owned by Negroes in Georgia. Porn Stats for Normative Relations. And the last one that I have, Negro Businessman in the United States. Painting Jail with Employed Turtles. This one is a kind of poetry. He's using to make French poetry because, you know, he got the complete library of the Johnson Publishing Company. When the building of the Johnson Publishing in Chicago was sold, they didn't know where to put the library. And Thiester Gates had bought a bank in the south side of Chicago, an enormous bank, a kind of Greek temple. And he was contacted by one of the daughter of Johnson, and she told him about that library in the building of the Johnson Company. And immediately he said, I know what to do with that library, and he put it in the bank. And now it's a beautiful center where are happening a lot of things like concerts or, you know, lectures, discussion about that. And those books are there. And between those books, there are the complete collection of the Johnson Publishing Company magazines. I mean, Jet magazine, Ebony magazine, and those magazines. And Jet, he had the Jet, the complete Jet collection. Relier, comment on dit?
Bound.
He had the complete collection bound, and he wrote words on the back of the books. And that makes a kind of poetry, more or less this kind of, it's a beautiful artwork, which was maybe also in the same show. And as he has a precise idea of different styles of avant-garde, modernity, and he made other versions of the same images produced by the boy students. And they were neon, there are neon versions. It's another moment in art history. It's much more the 60s. The painting were maybe something like the 50s. But done like this, they are completely contemporary. And he made the same work, the same images, not the same works, in neon. And those are images of
this neon. We need to wrap up the presentation?
Excuse me?
I
finished. Okay. It's my last word. It's my last word. It's maybe we got all, again the mountain, the aura, the mountain aura there. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.